Hi, so yeah, my name is Josh. I'm from the University of Huddersfield, and I just wanted to share with you today this project I've been working on called the Virtual Container Cluster, and specifically using it to build reproducible cluster software environments. So to get this out of the way first, we're using both Docker and Singularity in production on Campus Grid at the University of Huddersfield. I don't get all the hate towards using Docker in a traditional HPC system. It works quite well for us. Basically, a user can just run any of the commands in the job files, which is submit to the old PBS job scheduler. And if you had tried this maybe like 2 years ago, then yeah, each user is going to get free access on the system. But all you really need to do is to start the Docker daemon in a user namespace, and that prevents the equivalency of the root user that's actually inside the container and the root user outside the container. So the problem with that is that Docker relies on the user to supply these parameters, and we obviously can't rely on the users themselves to run containers in a secure manner. So our solution, we just came up with the proxy, because it's just a REST API. And basically, the proxy will handle the requests that the user's making. So if they specify privilege mode, it's going to strip that out. It's not very invasive into the way that the users used to be using Docker. Most of the images I've tried have worked okay this way. But in terms of like kind of convincing people to use the system, we found that they wanted to use it mostly because they can make an environment that they can guarantee will work every time, like to test the model with different inputs or something. They weren't really that motivated by this use case that someone else, or themselves in the future or whatever, can independently reproduce the result of this specific experiment. So I found it that it's quite interesting. But we also found a fundamental problem when people were trying this out in real life is that the software and the environments that we take for granted that's already on the HPC system is really not accessible at all once you actually try and reproduce an experiment. And to explain that, with a couple of examples, we had a user who realized that their own department actually has a really high spec Hadoop cluster, and they were using a Singularity container with an MPI program in. And they were launching that container using the host's MPI implementation. So they were using the container in place of the executable directly. But to actually use this, to reproduce this on their own cluster, or on their thought they had a cluster, they actually had to set up MPI first, passwordless, SSH, everything they had to do to turn that into the same type of cluster that they originally ran this container on. And they could do that. So there was this difference in understanding of what the cluster was, so they actually came to reproduce the experiment. The other thing was someone got thousands of CPU hours on Azure. And with Singularity, they kind of had a similar problem, is that they were kind of faced with virtual machine, blank virtual machines, and so on. They had to pick a Linux distribution, they had to work out how to kind of make that into the cluster first before they could run the container. And with Docker, Azure and Amazon have both got different ways you can run containers, but they still have to work out how inside that container, if we were launching kind of multiple containers for a parallel application, how to link those containers back together so that it was logically a cluster. And the tools like for the Amazon containers doesn't do that for you. You have to kind of make that up inside the container itself. So this was really frustrating for me because I told them that if they did it this way, they could run it on anything, basically. And that wasn't the case. So that kind of, I'd already started working on this tool. So it kind of just cemented the rationale for building another tool. is that I started to think about this idea of the reproducibility in the other direction. So like how much of the system can we actually need to include in the container in order to make it reproducible? And that begs the question of what does what is reproducibility? What does it actually mean? And that's a question that I'm trying to avoid, if at all possible, because everyone has a different opinion on what it is. But to summarise our perspective, is that the challenge is not really the code that we need to run, because the person making the container knows how to run that code anyway. They can build that environment, hopefully. The problem was everything else that we assumed the system would provide, that they didn't know how to include in that container. So this gives the working principle of this tool, is that let's say the application requires Hadoop, then we need to include the Hadoop runtime, whatever that environment is, within the container as well. So in a more general sense, you could replace Hadoop with MPI or whatever system you're using. But in a general sense, that means the execution model needs to be included in the container as well as the code that you want to execute. So I made two assumptions to avoid scope creep was designing the system and to be very focused on the goal was not becoming too opinionated. So that we assume the whole system has enough involved in the container runtime that's available. And if we need to run a container for a node, for example, for a parallel application, then there's a network connection between the devices. The second assumption is that you already have a method in order to launch these containers on the nodes. Whether that's running the commands in JavaScript, SSH directly to the nodes using Docker Swap or Kubernetes or something like that. We're not really bothered how we start containers as long as you can start it. Because there's other solutions which can solve that problem. It's a different problem than what we're trying to do here. So the virtual container cluster is really a framework for containerizing a complex software environment. It defines what's inside the container itself. So all these tools and things are actually really inside the container. So it means we can use Docker or CVR to it's not restricted to any specific container runtime. As long as that container runtime can use an entry point that's provided by the virtual container cluster. And this entry point will do discovery of the containers if you're using more than one in parallel mode. It also provides name resolution and orchestration of those processes in the containers. Because you think if we've got something a Hadoop cluster, certain services need to be running at certain times, and depending on ones that are running in the containers as well. So this service manager entry point really does everything that an init daemon should do on a normal system, a bit more lightweight, it reaps on this and stuff. But you can depend on services that are running in other containers when you're deciding how to start the system. So if we had just an MPI job, we want the SSH to be running in all the containers for the process launching. We can wait for the SSH daemons to be up in every container before we run the MPI run command within one of the containers, whichever one you're going to use to launch the processes. And we can do this without needing any external tool, so that it's a bit more portable. If you use Docker machine or something, that would mean you could use Docker. And that wasn't really acceptable. So, from the perspective of an experiment creator, you would just make the container like you normally would, and then install the VCC framework, set the entry point to the VCC tool. And at this point, you then have to write a description of how the processes in the container should start. So, for this example, for the MPI job, you can set an SSH daemon to run, and then you can create this block for the actual launching the job, and requires the SSH on that in the container. And the cluster start is a special requirement that will wait for the processing on the other containers as well, if we're using more than one instance of the same container image running on different nodes. So someone who then wants to run this container to reproduce an experiment or whatever, the only thing they need to do is to start a discovery service. It's just a key value store basically. It avoids having to enter IP addresses and postnames and stuff in a command line for every single node. And then they just start the instances of the container that they've been giving the address to this key value store. And that's pretty much it. The VCC tools will generate the machine file of GE1. It will handle all of the DNS resolution and everything, but the virtual nodes as it will be. To make this a bit easier, we started to create like base images that includes these configurations for common like clusters and middle work like MPI, Hadoop, Tor, PBS cluster and stuff that you can then extend with your own transfer and files. So this kind of brings it back to the original point of the user really doesn't know how to set up all the stuff. So we can do that for them, give them a foundation which we know works, and then they can just add their experiment to it. And they will know that wherever they run these containers, it doesn't have to logically be configured as a cluster. All it needs is the Docker runtime, and that cluster, what it means to be a cluster, is actually encapsulated in the containers as well. To make it a bit more interesting, the reproduced version isn't the only kind of use case for this, or the thing I'm thinking about. And you can actually try these commands yourself if you've got Docker, and you can spin up a multi-node PBS cluster in less than 60 seconds just by running. The first command starts to discovery, and then on every node, you just launch the second container image. You say one of them is a header. And as long as they're pointing at the same discovery container, you can just keep launching more workloads. And it will perform the contextual configuration for Tor, so it's going to generate a node list and all that stuff. And if you add on remove containers, it's going to reconfigure Tor as well. But yeah, to kind of bring it back together, the question that I asked myself when I was kind of thinking about what to say for this presentation was, does putting the code inside the container really just make an experiment reproducible? And from my perspective, the answer is kind of. And I think that's probably the feeling we've got from your presentations today anyway. But it's actually quite trivial to package some code in a possible way. But we learned that the actual execution model is just as much part of reproducing this experiment as anything else, the code that you're running, whatever data you've got, and then the resulting publication. So that's it. Thank you. And the code for this is ideal, so if you want to try it, please feel free to put any problems, just put me on my address. I would consider this kind of tool like alpha quality, because there's only really me and a handful of people that need